Hello?
There you are.
It's alive.
Good morning. Welcome to everyone who's visiting this morning, this beautiful morning. We are honored to have Ben, the director, and Sons and Daughters take our service this morning. They're can you hear me? They're very familiar with Central as they worship here every Saturday evening with as many or more than 100 in attendance. This service will be a little different than what we're used to, but follow along on the screen or in your bulletin and enjoy a new perspective. We need to remember again, the hospital has a privacy contract. Our own Wynn Curtis was in the hospital for approximately 2 weeks before we knew. before Colleen found out. Of course, she's been there and visited. Please call the church office. Please keep Wynn, Lionel Teetart, Eileen McLarty, Bob Allen, my friend Gloria, in your prayers. Ask God to keep them comfortable and well taken care of. Also say a prayer for Elsie Franklin, who lost her brother. Is there anyone else we should say a special prayer for? A great big thank you to Raylin, Kim, Colleen, Anne, Shelley, the two Nicoles, all the junior leaders for providing such a great Christian experience at Vacation Bible School this week. 50 children took part. And also a special thank you to Candace Rose, who shopped, cooked, and fed all these children. She's amazing. Also, thank you to all the volunteers who assisted in any way. Now, this is as close to as a singing group I'll ever get. I can't even whistle, so I am just really happy to turn it over to them.
Well, good morning. It's good to see all of you. This morning, we've got some songs that you're probably familiar with them lyrically, but the tunes are a little bit different, a little bit modern. So if you can stand, would you stand with me and stand with us? And we're going to worship. So here we go. For a thousand tongues.
Oh, for a thousand tongues to sing my great Redeemer's praise, the glories of my God and King, the triumphs of His grace.
My gracious Master.
Our sorrows cease. 'Tis a mute.
the power.
He breaks the power of canceled sin and sets the prisoner free.
His
blood can make the foulest clean. His blood availed for me. His blood availed for me.
I survey the wondrous cross.
When I survey the wondrous cross on which the Prince of Glory died, my riches gave.
richest gain.
My richest gain I count but loss and poor content on all my pride.
Forbid it, Lord.
Forbid it, Lord, that I should boast, save in the death of Christ my God. All the vain things that
from his head.
From his head, his hands, his feet,
sorrow and love,
sorrow and love, flow mingled down.
Did air such love?
Did air such love and soul.
Again, see from his head.
See from his head, his hands, his feet, sorrow and love flow mingled down. Did air such love and sorrow beat, or thorns compose so rich a crown. Oh, yeah. Oh. Far too small, love so amazing, so divine, demands my soul, my life, my. Oh,
the whole realm of nature mine.
We're the whole realm of nature mine. That we're an offering far too small. Love so amazing, so divine. Springtime and harvest, sun, moon, and stars in their courses above, is joined with all nature in manifold witness to thy great faithfulness.
Great. Thank you. Let's give a hand to the band. Thank you guys. You're awesome. Okay. Well, it's great to be here at Century United Church. When Chris asked us if we would do this service, we said, well, how much are you going to pay us? Let's talk about the money first. And after some negotiation, we agreed. No, I'm just kidding, you know. We are really excited to be part of the worship service here today. And we have been using the facility here at Central United for just about 4 years. It's gone by really quickly, but we have really enjoyed, yeah, thank you. Yeah, it's been great. We have really enjoyed our relationship, not only with the building itself, but with the church. We often talk about amongst ourselves how generous the congregation is and how wonderful the building is. So we just want to say thank you, first off. And I have a very short message to preach. It's about 3.5 hours, so I hope you're comfortable. Myself and my wife, we moved here in 2012 to start a new church. And we lived in Winnipeg, and we felt God calling us to come to Brandon to start a church that would preach the good news of Jesus, because it's good news, and give people who have not heard and believed a chance to believe and receive eternal life. And that's what we believe the church is supposed to do in any city, in any generation, is to share the good news of Jesus, because he said he's going to build his church. So when we came, you know, we were brand new, but we had a high value, and still have a high value for the many churches in Brandon that are doing great things and are serving the city. And even though our congregation is made up of, you know, a lot of young people, we have a great value for the generations that have come before us. And that's what my message is about today, is about the value of the generations that have gone before us. And I think sometimes we forget how valuable what God has done in the past is, and how it informs what God is doing today. I grew up going to an Anglican church. My parents were both Anglican ministers, my mom and my dad. And I really enjoyed the Anglican church. I loved going to church every Sunday. And my favorite part, and still is today my favorite part about denominational churches, is that they're old. It's not a joke, don't worry, it's okay. They're old, their buildings are old. And I love entering old church buildings. You know, I like them before people do the renovations. Renovations are nice, but I like entering before the renovations are done, because all the history is still in the walls. All the history is still in the pews. And I loved going to church as a kid. My parents are both ministers, and a big part of a tradition like the Anglican tradition, which is similar to the United tradition, with the stained glass and the pews and the beautiful organ like we have behind us. And even though I was, you know, just a little kid hearing the word of God being preached, I felt like I was part of something bigger than myself because of what the building spoke to me and what the people spoke to me. And I think that that is so important. And in a modern day world, we can sometimes lose track of that. And even we ourselves, maybe even for yourselves who are part of the congregation here at Central United, you know, you have a wonderful facility, and maybe you can look around and think, you know, where are the young people? Where are the people that are gonna take the baton and follow the walk of faith after us? And that's kind of what my message is about today, is hopefully an encouragement and a hope. And I love visiting old churches. In fact, even when I travel, I like going downtown. And what I love about churches that have been there for 100 years or 200 years is that they have prime real estate. They're always downtown in the middle of everything, just like Central United. And I love the motto of this congregation that says, a church with a heart in the heart of the city. I think that's amazing. That's a great, great thing. And so when I visit those churches, you know, I try and feel the history. I try and feel the history. Instead of quickly walking through, and, you know, some of my friends, I won't name any of the names because they may be here today, you know, they say, oh, this stuff is so old, you know. What's with the pews? Let's get some chairs in here. Or what's with the organ? We need some of those electrical instruments or whatever they say. You know, and I say, you know what? You know, before we do away with the pews, before we do away with the stained glass, before we do away with the organ, let's appreciate first why they're here and how they got here. Because all of that, to me, speaks about history. And when I was in Vancouver last year, I went to a church called St. Paul's Anglican Church, which is right downtown. The building was built in 1905. And I took a tour and just felt the history that was there. So today, what I want to share is about the importance of that history and how we can tap into that. And when I was praying and thinking about, you know, what to share with such a great congregation like this, I was just asking God, what's the message he wants to say? And I believe it's a message of hope and encouragement for Central United. And our first reading today comes from Psalm 78, verses 1 to 8. Psalm 78, verses 1 to 8. And I'll read it to you. You can follow along on the screen if you like. It's from the New American Standard Bible. It says, "Listen, O my people, to my instruction. Incline your ears to the words of my mouth. So I think when he's saying this, he's speaking to young people, and I feel like he's yelling at them. You know, the Bible doesn't have a lot of yelling, but I kind of read the yelling into the verse. It says, "Listen, all my people, to my instruction." And then he says again, "Incline your ears to the words of my mouth." Now, who do you have to tell things to twice? There's two groups of people you have to tell things to twice. There's either young people or people with bad hearing. So he's either speaking to people with bad hearing, which some of us may be in that category today, or he's speaking to young people. And it says, "Listen, all my people, to my instruction. Incline your ears to the words of my mouth. Listen to me. I will open my mouth in a parable. I will utter dark sayings of old, which we have heard and known, and our fathers have told us. We will not conceal them from their children, but tell to the generations to come the praises of the Lord and his strength and his wondrous works that he has done. For he established a testimony in Jacob and appointed a law in Israel, which he commanded our fathers, that they should teach them to their children, that the generation to come might know, even the children yet to be born, that they may arise and tell them to their children, that they should put their confidence in God and not forget the works of God, but keep his commandments and not be like their fathers." So he's talking to the kids. "Don't be like your parents. They're a stubborn and rebellious generation, a generation that did not prepare its heart and whose spirit was not faithful to God." So the psalmist says there's hidden sayings, there's dark sayings, there's parables that each generation has to pass down to the next generation. And that it's the privilege and the responsibilities of fathers and mothers and grandfathers and grandmothers to tell the preceding generations the great things that God has done. And I believe, like I was saying earlier, that as a building ages, as a church ages, as the people in the church age, they don't become less relevant. I believe they become actually more relevant and even more important. Because the more aged you are, you have wisdom that you learn from God that the next generation has to have. The next generation has to have that. And sometimes, you know, perhaps you can feel less relevant because you're surrounded by, you know, a world that's more modern, but the things that God taught you and that God did in you and for you and even for your parents are really relevant and helpful for the next generation. They have to know it. They have to hear it. And, you know, today, if you want to learn about, if I want to learn about what happened in World War I, you know, I'd have to go to, you know, I had to rent a movie or something and watch a documentary, but there's people here that your fathers and your brothers and your parents, they fought in that war. And you have those memories and you have those stories. And when they're passed down, it does something to the next generation that nothing else can do. So in the same way, your experiences with God, and I want to really encourage this congregation, I want to tell you that regardless of how many young people there are here or not today, I want you to put value in what God has done for you and God has done in you. And I want to tell you that the next generation, whether or not they know it, needs that. We need that. So people who have just begun to serve God, the young generation, they're just starting to serve God, they're just starting to worship. And yeah, Chris mentioned Vacation Bible School, and my office is downstairs, and I would walk out of the office and see this young boys and girls going to Vacation Bible School. And I was clapping enthusiastically because it was amazing. They're learning about God, and the team did such a great job making it fun and interesting. And I thought it was just the greatest thing ever because they need that. They need to be told. If we don't tell them the stories, if you don't tell us the stories, then we don't have the experience of what it looks like to serve God and worship God for 50 years, 60 years. So that's important for us. And the psalmist says that each generation must recount to its children the great works that God has done for them. This is so important that God made a law in Israel that his works to the fathers and mothers be recounted to the children. When the Israelites were crossing the Jordan, God said, "I want you to set up an altar with 12 stones." And they asked, "Why are we doing that?" And he said that when your children and your children's children, when they are walking around here and they see this altar, 12 stones, 12, a big pile of stones, and they ask you, what's up with these stones? You know, today they would ask you, what's up with these pews? Today they ask, what's up with the organ? You know, what's up with this? What's up with this stained glass? That's what they would ask today. But back then they were asking, what's up with the stones? And God said, that's your opportunity to tell them what I did for you. That there was a day when you had to cross a river and I parted the river. And today you might say, the reason why we have pews, the reason why we have the organ, the reason why we have the stained glass is because it's a reminder, because 100 years ago, 200 years ago, this is what God did, and we are the children that inherited that, and you are also inheriting that. And, my dad died when I was only 9 years old, so I didn't get to know him very long, and he was, as I mentioned, an Anglican minister. He did a lot of traveling in our country, in Africa. And because I didn't get a lot of time to get to know him, my mom had to tell me a lot about my dad. And there were so many things that my mom would tell me about my dad that I would see in myself. So without those stories, I just think that this is maybe who I am and the confidence is lacking. But when my mom tells me that this was in your father as well, this vision, these characteristics that God put in you that were in your father as well, it gives me confidence. And when you share your stories, when you are proud of your heritage, then it helps us have confidence in what God wants to do in our generation. And so when my mom was telling me these stories, actually, I took out my phone or my computer and I pressed record because I wanted my kids that are not even here yet to hear her voice tell her stories. And so that way they can get the same inheritance I have. And the psalmist says that when a preceding generation tells a proceeding, when the preceding tells a preceding generation the stories of God in their lives, faith is stirred up and strengthened, and they're more likely to follow God and put their trust in him. Our children, the next generation, they're more likely to inherit your faith. They're more likely to see the value in this congregation, to see the value in this building, to see the value in God when we tell them the stories. Because then God becomes more than just a figment of our imagination or just somebody in a book or on a screen. God becomes somebody who is real and living with flesh and blood, just like Jesus walking the planet, who worked in your lives. And they know he can work in our lives as well. Okay, let's go to our second reading. Our second reading is in Psalm, still in the book of Psalm, chapter 145. And we're going to read verses 3 and 7. It says, great is the Lord and highly to be praised. Great is the Lord and highly to be praised. And his greatness is unsearchable. One generation shall praise your works to another generation and shall declare your mighty acts on the glorious splendor of your majesty, and on your wonderful works I will meditate. Men shall speak of the power of your awesome acts, and I will tell of your greatness. They shall eagerly utter the memory of your abundant goodness and will shout joyfully of your righteousness. So God is so great, the psalmist is saying. God is so great. God is so magnificent. You can't search him out. Nobody can search him out. No one generation can search him out. But the psalmist says when one generation tells the next generation about the great works of God, then we build on the knowledge of God. It's impossible for one generation to completely search out God, understand everything there is to know about God. But when one generation says, hey, here's what God did for us, and here's where we came from, then the preceding generation can take that and build on that and go even further. And they can tell their kids, here's where your grandparents came from, and here's what God did for them, here's what God did for me. And the kids can dream, well, what can God do for us? What can God do for us? And, you know, I believe that the most lasting inheritance we can receive and pass on is the knowledge of God. It's the knowledge of God. And, you know, if we think about it, we're here in the year 2016, and we still don't have any hover cars, which is very disappointing. But we're here in the year 2016. We're here at Central United Church. But even the entire denomination, the United Church denomination, it wasn't born of its own accord. It stands on the shoulders of previous denominations. You know, 91 years ago, as you know better than I do, but 91 years ago, 1925, the Methodists, the Presbyterians, the Congregationalists, they formed the United Church. So even the United Church is a proceeding generation from a preceding generation. Without the Methodists and the Presbyterians and the Congregationalists and all that they believed and all that they were passionate and went after God, we would not be here today. But even those Methodists stood on the shoulders of John Wesley, who in the 1700s, you know, inflamed a great awakening for God across Europe and then spread into America and turned whole nations to God. So even the Methodists, they stand on the shoulders of John Wesley, but John Wesley didn't start it off himself because even he stands on the shoulders of Martin Luther, because John Wesley came to faith by hearing the revelation of justification by faith from Martin Luther in Romans. So everybody's standing on the shoulders of somebody else. Now, what would happen? Imagine with me if Martin Luther had never had that revelation and hadn't had the courage to tell his generation. What would have happened if John Wesley wouldn't have had the courage to stand on top of Martin Luther's revelation and tell his generation? What would have happened if the United Church hadn't formed on top of what the Methodists and the Presbyterians and the Congregationalists were doing? What would happen? And what would happen if Central United Church was never built? What would happen if this wasn't here? Well, if this wasn't here, then I wouldn't be here. Then what we do every Saturday night can't happen because what you do on Sunday mornings didn't happen. So every generation is standing on top of somebody else's generation. And that's the power of passing on that faith inheritance. One of the stories my mom told me about my dad was they went to school in Europe. That's where they got their education. And they went back to Rwanda. It's a little country in the middle of Africa to start their ministry. And they were part of this Anglican church in the capital city. But my dad was so passionate about the things of God and so passionate about telling people about Jesus that he couldn't just keep it in the church. He had to get it outside the church. So they started a prayer meeting in their home just to pray. And their prayer meeting got so big. They're living in this tiny little house, just a newlyweds. And their prayer meeting got so big that they either had to stop the prayer meeting or they had to knock down a wall. So you might have stopped the prayer meeting, but they knocked down the wall. And they to make room for more people. And even that was when he was younger, but as he got older and got more established in the church, he didn't just want to stay in his congregation. He wanted to help other congregations. So he would go to nearby towns and cities and help congregations there. So that passion for God, that faith that he had, helps me when I think about, well, I'm moving from one city to a different city, but I have an inheritance of somebody being so passionate that they're willing to do that as well. And I'm following in those footsteps. Okay, and our final reading comes from the book of 2 Timothy, chapter 1, verses 5 and 6. This is a wonderful verse where Paul is writing to Timothy, and he says, "For I am mindful." And when he writes this, just a little bit of context, when he writes this verse, Timothy is very discouraged. Timothy is a young pastor. He's trying his best to lead this church, but because he's young, the elder people in this church, they look down on him because they think he's too young to be leading, and they don't want to listen to what he says. And he's getting very discouraged, and he writes to his spiritual father, to Paul, and he says, I don't know what to do. They're looking down on me because of my youth. What do I do? And Paul writes to him this letter to encourage him. One of the first things he says, verses 5 and 6 that we're reading today, he says, "I am mindful of the sincere faith within you, which first dwelt in your grandmother, Lois, and in your mother, Eunice, and I am sure that it is in you as well. For this reason, I remind you to kindle afresh the gift of God, which is in you through the laying on of my hands." Amazing. So when Paul writes to Timothy to encourage him, you know, he could tell him, "Hey, Timothy, you're a great guy. You're going to make it. You have all the gifts that you need." But he doesn't do that. Paul says, there's faith inside of you. And the way I know that is because there was faith in your grandmother. I know there's faith in you because there was faith in your grandmother. Paul reminds them that he's not the first, that his grandmother had faith, that his mother had faith, and that faith is still alive in him today. And Paul tells him, "Timothy, you come from a long line of people who have faith. You come from a long line of leaders in the church, and you can do it. Your grandmother did it, your mother did it, and you can do it as well. So because of that, you need to stir up the gift inside of you and believe God for great things in your generation." So this passage teaches us that faith can be received as an inheritance. Faith can be received as an inheritance. And I think that's the greatest inheritance that we can pass on, is faith. That's the absolute greatest inheritance. Because after we leave here this Sunday, you know, we do our lives, we have our families, we have our homes and our careers and our businesses and so on and so forth. But the only time that we can build a church is when we come together. When I'm by myself, I'm building my life, I'm building my family, my home. But when I come and I'm part of a congregation, that's the only thing I'm building that will outlive me. That's the only thing I'm building that our entire city can look at and say, there's God at work. Isn't that amazing? So my 3.5-hour message is cut down to about 20 minutes. So as I close my message today, what I want to do is I want to say just a short prayer for this church and for the church in our city. But before I do that, I just want to say thank you to this church, Central United Church, and to the members that are here today and the members who came before that are in heaven now. I want to say thank you, because if it wasn't for your faith and if it wasn't for your faithfulness, there wouldn't be a place for my generation, our generation, to start meeting and to carry on that faith. So perhaps you think that, you know, what's the point sometimes, you know? And perhaps maybe you look around and you feel discouraged at maybe because in past years, past decades, this place was full. And you think, you know, I'm feeling a little bit discouraged. But don't feel discouraged and don't feel irrelevant, because what you have to share is still powerful. And the fact that you're still meeting and still keeping this place going means that a new generation can say, hey, they did their work, they served God for decades, now it's my turn. And when I look at you, when I look at your silver hair, not gray hair, silver is valuable. When I look at your silver hair, I think, you know, I hope that one day when I'm silver haired as well, I can say that I serve God for as long as the people I'm seeing serve God. So let me say just a short prayer. Father, in Jesus' name, we want to thank you so much for this congregation. We want to give you glory and praise for your great works and this building here, Central United Church, and this congregation is a monument. It's an altar. It's a house that speaks of your great works for past generations and of your desire for great works in the next generation. And Father, I want to pray that there will be a generation that arises that would take the baton of faith being offered and do great works in their generation. In the name of Jesus, amen. Amen. I'm going to invite Chris to come up and do the offering invitation.
Thank you, Ben. I found that very inspirational. Throughout the biblical story, we meet people who said yes to God. May our offering today be part of our yes to the call to give in response to the blessings we have received. The offering will now be received. Thank you, Heather. What we offer to you, O God, we could do not alone. These gifts are yours, and we return them to you, asking your blessing on them and on us, that we may go and make a difference in the world. Amen. Our prayers of and for the people. For those who ache today, hold them in your tender embrace, God. For those who weep, comfort them. For those who are lost, guide them. For those who find themselves on shifting sands, be their rock and firm foundation. For those who are frightened, be a light in their journey. We pray today in the strong name of Jesus, who is guest, host, and stranger, the one who invites us to the banquet. We pray together now as he taught us, pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Go, live the dream, serve the Lord, answer God's call, be blessed forevermore. Amen. They're going to play Great is Thy Faithfulness, and we can listen for one more time, and then we can exit. Thank you very much. And thanks, John, Heather, sons and daughters. It's been great. Great is
Thy